The Richard Dixon Show on Talk 99.5.
Don't bother crying, don't bother crawling, it's all over now, no use in stalling. The love I once felt, I don't feel anymore for you. This time I'll even open the door for you. You walked out when I was down, when now I'm well off, and look, look who's coming round. Where were you?
That's a Grassroots from the late 60s. That's sort of a dating story.
Yeah, tell me about it.
He was with this girl, and then he was down on his luck, and so she hit the road. Because women can smell money.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Let me tell you this. There's a guy used to be on the pro golf tour named Bill Glasson. He still plays some, and he had long blonde hair. Mm-hmm. And in the PGA media guide, they asked these guys, what are your favorite activities? And he put something like surfing and rock climbing. And they said, Bill, do you do that? He said, no, I just put that because I've attracted girls. But then I realized they just look straight down the money list, and it doesn't really matter. And that's how. So this guy's down, and this guy from the Grassroots are singing about, he went down on his luck, and she left him. Then he got back to better off, and she came hunting again. He said, where were you when I needed you?
That's right.
That's right. You know, did you ever notice the ratio of phone calls that you get with people who want you to do something for them in ratio who can do something for you? 20 to 1, 50 to 1. How many times does a person call up and say, I can make your day a little better?
Not very often.
Right. Usually it's, Donna, you're connected in the entertainment industry, aren't you? Do you know, is there any way you can get me a, you know, that's how it starts.
Right.
You could do that for me. And I would consider it a personal favor if you, how about some repayment? You know, I don't remember you ever doing anything for me, but help me refresh my memory.
Mm-hmm.
No,
mm-hmm.
None of that.
But you know, Spud, you break that down to a professional question. I get a zillion questions, phone calls, texts about an animal.
Right.
And to me, it's second nature. I don't mind answering them. My goal is to get them into the clinic.
Right.
But it happens all the time. And if I know someone is asking me that is in the music business or the entertainment industry, and I'm helping them, I may turn around and say, hey, by the way, I hear Styx is coming to town next month. Anything you can do?
And so, they're more likely to do it once you've done something for them.
Sure. And it's my nature not to usually call people and ask them for favors.
I have a hard time with that, too.
Right. But if
I hate to ask people
sometimes ask me and recruit me to be a fundraiser.
I hate that.
Oh, no. I don't want to call anybody and ask them for money.
Do I do?
Participate in fundraisers by?
We will. The Caldwell Mill Animal Clinic will donate items for
silent auctions. Oh, that's different. But you won't contact people and ask them to.
Heck no, I won't even contact somebody to sponsor my softball team.
I've seen your softball team. It wouldn't do any good.
Max's Deli went out of business. They said, well, go find someone else. I said, I'm not walking
in. Eli's Jerusalem Grill has two locations now.
Do you know him well enough to ask for him?
I'm not asking anybody for anything.
I'm trying to hit up Yossi Friedman.
That's a good one.
I said, go talk to Eli.
Well, the world is full of givers and takers, and unfortunately, there are a lot more takers, willing takers, than there are givers.
That's like when all is said and done, there's a lot more said than done. And that's why we're on the radio, right? Because we don't have to do crap. We can just talk, and we're halfway through the Richard Dixon Show. The voices you hear are mine, Mark Spud Friedman, hosting, co-hosting with me, the lovely and talented Donna Francavilla of FranklySpeakingCommunications.com.
Yes.
And the lovely, talented Andy Sokol of Caldwell Mill Animal Clinic, located near the intersection of Caldwell Mill Road and Valleydale. Right out there near the Publix.
Should we guess what kind of dog he has, or do you already know?
I know, but you could guess.
Because they say pets look like their owners.
Oh, wow. Donna, you have not seen my dog.
Look.
Yeah, you did. I showed you a picture.
But she said, first she saw you, she said hippopotamus. I said, that is cold. Why would you say that to somebody? Okay, so what kind of dog does he have?
You know, I actually did a story on that. Do pets look like their dogs? And it was Doodah Day. So it was a great angle for a radio story. Because you can't you know, put pictures on the radio, right?
Right.
Like, nobody knows what we look like, really.
Unless now that Monica spilled the beans, they do. But until today, they didn't.
Yeah, now that we're
on Facebook
Live. Because
I told people I looked like Harrison Ford.
So
instead, I look like a Ford Edson. Go ahead.
I don't know what kind of dog. Should I describe to people what you look like, and then, or you can describe what you look like, and then we can try to guess what kind of dog?
You look at him and tell him what kind of dog you think he is.
Well, I did see a picture, but I don't remember the kind of dog. I would say a German Shepherd.
No.
See, that's because of the black and gray look that you're developing like that. I was going to go maybe Schnauzer with that, you know, the fuzz around the chin. And
he's not going to
speak to me. He owns an Alabama Brown Dog Terrier similar to Wilson.
Right. And, you know, I see your angle at coming at this based on visual, but I think Marty and I have very similar personalities. He and I can walk into any place, any restaurant, any facility, and everybody notices us.
Is that an actual technical name, or did you give it that name?
Technical?
Alabama Brown Dog Terrier. Is that a breed?
It's a breed.
I mean, it's known as Alabama. Would you have one in California and say that's an Alabama Brown Dog Terrier?
Here's the story.
Okay.
You know Dooley.
Dooley
is the original Alabama Brown Dog Terrier. He is owned by our groomer, Molly.
Right.
And he has a Facebook page. If you haven't Facebook friended
Dooley Mosley.
And he is so funny because she gives so much great verbiage to him. Anyway, so everybody kept asking her, what breed is he? And she got tired of saying mutt or terrier mix. Mm-hmm. So she just opened up. She goes, it's an Alabama Brown Dog Terrier. And people go, really?
Yeah. It sounds so sophisticated.
So last year I was down at Art Festival down on Morris Avenue with Marty, and somebody goes, hey, what breed of dog is he? I said, an Alabama Brown Dog Terrier. And the guy goes, those must be expensive. And I go, no, you can pick one up at any trailer park because that's where Marty came from.
That's the salesmanship as opposed to the honesty part.
That's right.
But Wilson is also an Alabama Brown Dog Terrier, but Wilson was rescued from a sewer. Some people had thrown him and his brothers and sisters in a sewer, and he got rescued, and we got him when he was about 6 months old. And so we asked the usual questions, how old is he? And it was mid-August. They said about 6 months, so we assigned him a birthday of Valentine's. Uh-huh. He just had his ninth birthday. And they said, what breed is he? And they said, we never know, but if we had to guess, you could tell he's mostly a terrier, and if we had to guess secondarily, might be Australian Shepherd or something like that. And so then when we got him, he has a propensity, and I think this is common to Jack Russells. He likes to disembowel stuffed things.
Oh.
He likes to tear open stuffed toys and tear the insides out. I don't know what the motivation is, but he likes to do it. One day I came home and every pillow in the house had been emptied, and it looked like it had snowed in the living room, like 3 or 4 inches worth of. And he's sitting up on the couch smiling like, see what I did?
He was really proud of himself.
He was. He had accomplished his goal. So people would say, what kind of dog is he? I'd say, half terrier, half terrorist.
And hide your pillows.
You're listening to the Richard Dixon Show. Our phone number is 545-9950, and we're dealing with two separate questions. One is the big stupid question of the day, which is, if you could go to lunch with someone from the past at Donna's expense at the restaurant of your choice, who would you go with and what would you ask them? And the second question is, do you have a really good, interesting radio dating story? Blind dating or internet dating?
Internet dating.
I want to hear the story you told about your friend. So
this was a new friend, and he had said he had bad experience with dating. And I said, well, tell me what happened. He said, well, I'd meet a girl online, and her picture was beautiful, and she seemed to have a nice figure, and I'd tell her I'd meet her at a local bar. The woman would come in, women would come in, and they'd walk by, and maybe that's her, but they'd move away from him and go sit somewhere else. And then another woman would come in, and a third, and he thought, oh my goodness, all these gorgeous women, and none of them are coming over to sit next to me. Well, then a very big woman came in. He said she was
bigly,
so big.
Huge. It's going to be huge.
Huge woman who he said was big enough to block the sun, and she came down and sat next to him.
Hi, my name is Eclipse.
It's
nice to So
he was a big proponent of honesty in internet dating. He said,
were the pictures fake?
Apparently,
or had they been like photoshopped?
But what he said was there was a picture of like a quarter of her face, or a profile.
Man. You cannot.
It does not tell the whole story.
No, you cannot go with a part. So here's what I think. Tell me if you think this is a good strategy.
Yeah.
You find the girl and she's willing to go out with you. So here's what you do. You tell her, I'm going to meet you at the food court of the Galleria. I want you to sit in the middle and wear a red baseball hat. And you sit in the middle, and I'm going to walk around upstairs. And if you look like your picture, I'll come right down and we'll go somewhere to eat. And if you don't look anything like your picture, like if we're supposed to meet at 7 and it gets to 7:20, you know the answer.
Wow.
Go get yourself some Chick-fil-A and have a nice life. But I ain't coming down there. If you told me you were 5:06 and 1:30 and you're actually 5:06 and 2:30 and that's not what I was interested in, I ain't coming down.
And Spud, what happens if she turns this around and says,
it's okay. I used to bother me when I got rejected. I don't care anymore. It's this, you crest over this certain age, and I don't remember, it wasn't like I woke up one morning and all of a sudden, but if a woman doesn't like me, I'm okay. If she thinks too short, too fat, too gray-haired, too inert, you see on these websites, and they say, these girls say, I think we're a good match, and I look at their thing, and it says, I like opera and ballet and rock climbing, and I said, well, did you read my profile? I'm the ultimate couch potato. I don't get up unless I have to go to the bathroom or the refrigerator and get a drink. That's it. I play trivia. I sit on my butt in bars and casinos and play trivia, and occasionally I'll go out and play golf. That's it. If you want that, I'm right here. If you want some rock climber, you know, if you're looking for someone like Jean-Claude Van Damme, you ain't gonna be happy. Don't friend me. Let's see what JC has to say. All right, JC, you're it's your shot.
Enjoy the show. Thanks for taking my call to all of you on a happy Monday. I'll do the blind date first. I married my last blind date.
Wow.
Set up by a good friend who basically said, you're going to take her out, and told her friend she was going to go out. And this beautiful woman opened the door, and 9 months later we got engaged, and here we are almost 18 years, getting ready to move into our last home.
Wow,
that's a beautiful story.
Are you still friends with the friend who set you up?
Oh, absolutely. Not only that, she's getting married.
Can I have her number?
To another blind date.
So if this girl had walked in and she looked like Madea, well, how are you going to react to that?
Well, I would have sat down and talked to her, obviously, because she's Madea, because she's damn funny.
Okay, how about Aunt Esther from Sanford and Son? Or Gladys Kravitz? What if it had been Gladys Kravitz that walked in on you?
I would have asked her about my neighbors.
That's good. JC gets me.
JC, did you see a picture of this lady?
Let me answer the question.
Oh, yeah, big stupid question.
Who to have lunch with.
Your wife.
I already have lunch with her. So I would have lunch with George C. Patton, and I'd want to know why he just didn't go ahead and push to the 38th parallel.
They wouldn't let him.
Started orders once.
Oh, that's a good idea. You could have asked him if he thought George C. Scott did a good job of portraying him, too.
He already answered that in an interview and said no.
He said no?
He was much rougher in his opening speech than Patton was.
I just remember that thing. And we're going to go through the enemy like crap through a goose.
Exactly.
You don't win a war by dying for your country. You win a war by making the other dumb SOB die for his country.
Correct.
I love it. Thanks, JC.
Got a quick question.
Okay, go.
All right. On the dog. I'd also want to know why he named his dog Willie, because I had one, and they're anything but a Willie.
Patton. That's what he Patton. Said. He said, you're not a William. A little bitty frou-frou dog came up to him and frightened him off, and he said, he named him William for William the Conqueror, and he said, correct. You're no William, you're a Willie. That's terrific. Thanks, JC. Appreciate the time. We'll take a break here. We'll come back. More of your phone calls, more sad dating stories from three single individuals sitting lonely in the studio with no food and no friends. You're listening to Mark Spud Friedman and Pals on The Richard Dixon Show on Talk 99.5. Wait for it. call is very important to us. Please remain on the line, and our first attendant will be with you. And playing air musical instruments. Andy's on the keyboards and the trumpet. Donna's dancing like she was on Soul Train. And we're just having a good time up in here. That's another good question. Does anybody really know what time it is?
There you go. It's a rhetorical question.
A big hit for Chicago.
I bet you Socrates asked those questions.
He had a sundial. It's a big hit for Chicago. That was early in my college. And they're touring now with the Doobie Brothers, but they're not coming to Birmingham. Atlanta's the closest place, but my sister who lives in Houston has tickets to see them there. That's two pretty good groups I'd enjoy watching.
Oh, they would
lots
be fantastic.
Of lots of hits.
But I have a question for you. So did you see the TV show where I was dancing in it? Because I used to dance on a Soul Train type show.
In Washington, D.C. for Donald Trump?
No, in Philadelphia.
Really?
In New Jersey.
There was American Bandstand?
Something like that. We used to cut school, and if you're any... Anybody?
Cut school.
Yeah, school children. You didn't hear this from me. But I used to cut school in high school, and we'd take several outfits, and then we'd go to the studios, and we'd dance with one another, flipping each other over and doing all those things you can do
poodle
when you're 19,
skirts and stuff
18
like that?
Years old. Not poodle skirts. I'm not that old. Thank you. Where's his knee? I got to kick
it. It can't. Oh, God dang. Linneman.
I got him.
So you were a dancer, gold dancer.
So what happened was, apparently about 10 years ago, they started running the reruns of these shows because it was popular. The music had become popular again. And I got a phone call from New Jersey.
It's like Glenn Miller and Tommy Dorsey, that far back?
Not that far. Where's his other name?
That's it.
And so I got a phone call from a high school friend saying, we're on TV again, dancing. And I said, thank God I don't live in New Jersey.
Why don't we get a recording of that and post it on franklyspeakingcommunications.com? So the songs today are about questions, and we blew the whole segment on that song. But we got more questions coming up, more dating stories. Jim, please hang on. We'll get to you after the break. You're listening to The Richard Dixon Show. Are you wondering where Richard Dixon is? It's spring break, and he's going topless in Panama City Beach on the balcony. Drinking till he can't stand up anymore. He said, give me one every 10 minutes till I pass out, then every 15 minutes after that. We'll be back right after the news.
Napa Know How.
Napa guy knows not to judge a man by his car's multicolored paint job or absence of modern gadgetry. Who cares if it's technically old enough to vote and the windows are powered by the strength of your left arm? Your monthly payment is zero, and it'll stay that way. Because with over 500,000 parts and a little Napa know-how, you can keep anything on the road. She may not be pretty, but she's all yours. That's Napa know-how.